Hey there, I'm going to show you in as quick a manner as I can with getting all the information I need to tell you how you replace a turntable belt. Obviously that's how this works. Now there are turntables that don't use belts, but those are more modern. This is from 1987. There's a few things I need to explain first. One, obviously do not have it plugged in. Do not have either the phono jack cable or the power cable plugged in. And also don't have the dust cover on it if yours has one. Kind of obvious too. Make sure your tone arm is secured. For example, this tone arm, $90 on its own. Not easy to replace. You don't want to replace it unless there's something wrong with it. So have that locked. You might want to take this off if you have to turn yours upside down. Some require bolts that have to be taken off to access this. Make sure you take this off. In fact, one of the other things I want to say is, like, mine's fine, but if I wasn't sure if I needed a new belt or not, there's a few things, ways you'd know. One is if you have it in 35 or 45 and it doesn't sound right, it's not playing at the right speed like it's supposed to. Or you could just take it off and look at yourself and see if it's dried, cracked, or splitting, or, you know, any of that kind of stuff. It's basically the same as if you've used the vacuum that uses belts. You should know when that needs to be replaced too. So once all that's out of the way and all that kind of stuff, by the way, you should clean this too after so many hours of use. It's usually suggested about 40. So we'll leave that there. Now this is the platter. Obviously the rubber fingers on top. Never try playing a record without it. This is right there. Now on mine, like I said, some might be different. The belt has to go behind this thing. This is what actually moves it when the power's on. See, I can move the belt right here. My belt's fine, as I said. I have to put the camera down when I pick this up. It's actually very heavy. So that's one thing I do want to suggest is if yours has to be moved upside down, like if I had to turn this whole thing upside down, make sure you take this part off. See, like, watch me. Pull it off. Pull it against there. It's still attached to this big metal disc, but you do not want to turn it upside down when it's connected to that, because it's going to put strain on the belt, and it's going to rip it and tear it, and then you're definitely going to need a new one. By the way, I'm so glad I don't need a new one, because I have no damn idea what size mine is, where to get them, or what kind they are, or anything like that, so I'm hoping it never breaks. I don't use it every day, all day anyway, but I use it for a couple hours on end, but I like to take care of things, like clean it all. It's actually another reason I'm making this video finally is because I wanted to take it out of its hole so I can clean it. But anyway, so what you want to do is pull this up and off. And it worked easier the second time. This is the second time me doing the video, by the way. I want to do it a little better. So this is where the belt goes around. It goes on this thing. Now I could take it all the way off and show you, but there's no point in that. See, there's a couple of white marks on the belt. That's from stretching it, so I gotta be careful how many more times I do it. So they get on this thing. Just in case you're curious, this is what it looks like underneath. There's more inside, obviously. But this is the thing that actually is the automatic part, because this is an automatic one that makes the thing turn back. So that's what that mechanism is. You can hear it clicking. Now, what I was just trying to show you when it was kind of dark, the belt goes around behind, like right here. It doesn't go in front. You want to make sure of that. So say if you get a new one, or you have your same one as I do here, and you put it back on, what you do is put it around this all the way. Just leave it like that. Turn upside, turn the thing back where it belongs. Put it back down here. One thing I do suggest is, there's people obviously have talked about this before and done it better, and they know more about turntables. I'm kind of new to it, but still I've learned some things. Make sure when you put it down like this, it didn't sag down and get pinched. These are very thin and fragile. You don't want to wreck them. Imagine they're not cheap. Now, putting it back on, which we're almost done, is very simple. Pull it up like this. Be very careful. Pull it behind the thing there. Make sure it's on the cap stand. That's what I call it. It's basically kind of like a VCR. And there you go there. Now, as I was saying, be very careful when you're doing this, by the way. It's probably not good I'm doing this, but it's a way you can tell. As you're pulling it with your hand very carefully, by the way, very slowly, you can feel if there's any sagging. If there's not, then it's fine. It's also a way you can check your current one. And you can see there, you can watch it. It's moving fine. Move it around a few times just to make sure both ways, even though the record player only moves one way. Next thing to do, once you're sure of that, put this on. Now next, plug it in and all that. You don't need sound, because you can actually hear a record without, you know, speakers hooked up. I should just mention that. Try it on both speeds. Make sure it's spinning at the correct, you know, it actually spins when you're not moving it. Then take a record I suggest you don't care about, or it's kind of messed up already, you know, you have a duplicate, you don't want them to ham to it. A 45 and a 35, like I said, if yours has two speeds, maybe it has a 78, maybe it's 78 only. Make sure it's playing it at the correct speed. of course, make it a song you actually know in and out what it sounds like at a correct speed. I'm pretty sure if anyone's ever done this, even if you're just curious, like if it's a 35 record, you accidentally or intentionally put it on 45, and it sounds slower. If it's at the correct speed and all that, and it's moving, and there's no problems, and it's not, like, jerking or having a hard time trying to move, then it's fine. Now, the one thing I can tell you is what, if anything else, you have to do special if you're an actual DJ, you know, doing this kind of crap, which actually is bad, wrecks the needles and all, stylus. So, you're on your own for that one, but as far as just replacing the belt, this is about all you need to know. Now, as I said in the very beginning, not all turntables, record players, whatever you prefer to call it, phono player, phono jack player, they're not all the same. As I mentioned, that big black one, I didn't mention it yet, I didn't in the first try. I had a big black one, it was kind of multi-thing in one, and if you wanted to get to the record part, which actually does have a problem, it's not playing the speed right, I was going to fix it, but it's not mine anymore, it's down in the basement, you had to take bolts off. So it was even more involved to get to, and it didn't have this heavy metal, professional, expensive disc thing. It didn't have a $90 tune arm either, it was all plastic. So there's that too, you got to make sure. It's kind of good I don't need a belt because I don't know what kind this is, I don't know how big it is, I don't know if they're special kind or they're all the same size or anything like that, or even where to get them, so hope I never have to get one. I'll deal with styluses, it took me long enough to find a place I can get one of those, but, you know, that's all there is to it, so thanks for watching and listening, and I will see you next time. If you have any other questions, I can field those for you to my best of my ability. I'll see you.